Are you excited? I am. God is good. And I trust that you've come expectant, ready to be blessed. Stand by, put your seatbelts on for the adventure that God has got for us this evening and in the days ahead. Thank you, Jesus. Unless you have been asleep, you will have realized that in Eastern Europe there is a conflict in Ukraine. And I thought that it would be good for us as a church to pray for our brothers and sisters in that nation, the church there. Joshua, there's a quote on the screen from the foreign affairs director of the Ukrainian Pentecostal Church. And it says, I and all ministers will stay in Kiev. We continue our intercessory prayers and talk to people to reduce panic and help those in need. So they've declared this evening that they're going to stay there. They're not going to run. And they're going to be amongst the people to reduce the panic and serve them. The minister of the Irpin Bible College and professor of the theological seminary there, it says, when this is all over, the citizens will remember how Christians have responded in their time of need. We will shelter the weak, serve the suffering, and mend the broken. And as we do, we offer the unshakable hope of Christ and his kingdom. There's a lot of panic going on, but we can offer a hope, an unshakable hope, Christ and his kingdom. And then there's another slide here. Prayer request. First to stop the aggressor, but then for peace of mind to respond with Christian character and not from human hate. I think the church is recognizing that, you know, that the response is not hatred towards their fellow Russians, because most of their fellow Russians aren't behind this. so they just want to respond with love and that to be a testimony. Here's some prayer points: to lament the loss of human life and the devastation of war, to stop the aggressor and that the war would end, that refugees would find sanctuary, for Christians as they serve and worship amid the conflict, that people would seek and find Jesus, and then against casual prejudice toward Russian citizens. So we're just going to pray right now for the church in Ukraine and their work, and just to pray that the enemy will be thwarted in this situation. Father, we thank you for the church in Ukraine. And Father, I thank you for the ministers and the pastors who have declared that they're not going to run, but they're going to stay and they're going to support and serve the citizens there. They're going to shelter the weak. They're going to serve the suffering, amend the broken. And they are going to offer the hope of the unshakable kingdom of Christ and the unshakable hope of the gospel. Father, we continue to pray that the aggressor will be stopped. Father, we pray that you will thwart the plans of the enemy. We pray that refugees would find sanctuary for Christians as they serve and worship amid the conflict, that people in the midst of this will still find Christ. And we pray against the casual prejudice against Russian citizens. Father, we pray for love to prevail. And Father, where we know that where love is, the enemy is thwarted. Thank you, Jesus. We pray for the diplomats and all those that would be talking. Give them godly wisdom to find a long-term solution to this conflict in Jesus' name. And Father, we pray that what the enemy meant for good, you will turn around for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen. As we begin this evening's service, we pray for those others amongst us, Lord Jesus, who are still suffering and are still in pain and discomfort. We speak healing over their lives in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Gail.
Amen. Good evening. Okay, so tonight I'm reading a few excerpts from Matthew 24, verses 6 to 14. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see that you are not troubled, for all these things must come to pass. Nation will rise against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and pestilences and earthquakes in various places. Many false prophets will rise up and deceive many. Lawlessness will abound, and the love of many will grow cold. And this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world as a witness to all nations. We've already been talking about what is happening in Europe. You don't have to watch the news for very long to know that nations are at war and nations are rising up one against another. Famine and malnutrition affects many nations. Pestilence and disease has just caused a worldwide pandemic. Lawlessness has increased dramatically. And there have already been over 2,000 earthquakes so far this year. I looked that up on the computer. So there you go. But notice that verse 14, the last part that I read there, Matthew chapter 24, says that this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the world. No matter what is happening in this world, we continue to proclaim the good news of salvation in Jesus. Amen. Don't get so preoccupied with what is going on around you that you get sidetracked from releasing the kingdom authority you have from within you. Amen. Many are fearful, worried, anxious, depressed. You can't wonder at it when you know what they're having to live through. But we have the good news of the gospel, the truth that will set men free. Let's continue to proclaim it, because this gospel of the kingdom will be preached in all the earth. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. And we thank you that we do not need to be alarmed. Because, Lord, your word tells us what will happen in the end days. And we can look to you and trust you and know above all things that your gospel would be preached in all the earth. So that everyone has the chance to hear that you are Lord. So that everyone has the chance to hear of your grace and your goodness. Everyone has the chance to know that there is forgiveness in the blood of Christ. Everyone has the chance to give their heart to you and be part of your family, part of your kingdom, where there is no fear in death, but only eternal life with you in glory forever. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that you have said your gospel will be preached. Hallelujah. The good news of the kingdom. And Lord, we thank you for that. Hallelujah. Perhaps one or two of you just like to lift your voices to him right now in prayer and thanksgiving. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
You alone, O Lord, worthy to be worshipped. You alone are worthy to be praised. This evening, Father, as we come before your name, as we come, Father God, to worship you, Father, to praise your holy name, to be lifted higher, Father God, we honor your name. You are a good God. You are never fail us, Father God. You said you'll never leave us nor forsake us, Father God. In times of trouble, happiness, whenever, you are always there, Father God. You never short any second. You are always with us, Father God. Thank you, Father God. Sometimes we see ourselves not seeing your hand, but God, you'll be lifting it up. We thank you for that, Lord. This evening, Father, we say, you are the King of the King. You are the Lord of the Lords. Reign forever. Amen. Reign forever, Lord. In the name of Jesus, we worship you, Father. We worship your name. Blessed be the King. Blessed be the Messiah. Blessed be our Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
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 We want to see Jesus lifted high, a banner that flies across this land, that all men might see the truth and know that he is the way to heaven. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. So here's the scripture that we looked at last week. Conscious that last week I skipped a lot that was in my notes. So I'll do a quick review, add in some of the gaps, as well as add in some of the contributions that we had from home group last week in the different groups. But to each one, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. We are united in the Spirit. That is who unites us. But each of us has unique gifts, has spiritual gifts, have ministries that God has given it to us. 1 Corinthians 12, 4 to 5 says this: now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of ministries and the same Lord. And up on the screen, we'll have 1 Corinthians 12, which lists the spiritual gifts. And we have wisdom, knowledge, tongues, interpretation of tongues, healings, miracles, gifts of faith, each given to us by the Holy Spirit as he determines. But what unites us is the Holy Spirit. We're all different. So we often might in church circles talk about the charismatic gifts. Charis is the Greek word for grace. And what it means is that these gifts are freely given. They are graciously given without being earned. They are favorably given to us as God determines. It's his goodwill. They're not earned or dependent or on or because of our behavior. We do not have to be perfect before God can use us. Now, this is important when we talk about ministries and gifts. This is relevant to where we're going, by the way. So often people will think to themselves, although they might not articulate it to other people, is that they cannot be used by God because they are not worthy. They're not good enough. They look at themselves and they see themselves as nobody else sees them. And they look at themselves and they say, well, what a rotten scoundrel that I am. Look at what a failure that I am. I have loads of doubts. I don't behave myself in the way that I should. Therefore, God is never, ever going to use me. Well, that is not quite right, because we've already reminded ourselves that these are charis gifts. They are grace gifts. They are given, not dependent upon our behavior. Think about the disciples, for example. They weren't particularly an example of decent people. James and John were known as the sons of thunder. Why were they known as the sons of thunder? Because they were always arguing with one another. They had a bit of a short fuse and they were known for losing it. But yet God used them. Then think on this. John 12 records an occasion when Mary took a pound of very costly oil of spikenard, anointed Jesus' feet and wiped it with her hair. And then read what the response of Judas was to this. But one of his disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, who would betray him, said, "Why was the fragrant oil not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" Then he said, not that he cared for the... This he said, not that he cared for the poor, but because he was a thief and had the money box, and he used to take what was put in it. Think about this. We all know that Judas, therefore, was pinching money from the disciples' petty cash, from Jesus' petty cash, throughout the time that he was a disciple with Jesus, ministering with the other disciples. Think about this. Whilst he was casting out demons and healing the sick and doing the signs and wonders and the miracles, he was pinching money from Jesus' petty cash. Now, why do I say that? Not to condone bad behavior. Not to condone you going robbing a bank or pinching somebody else's money. No, 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 don't get me wrong on this. But the point that I'm making here is that we do not have to be perfect before God would use us. In fact, if God only uses perfect people, then none of us are worthy to be used. But hallelujah, the gifts that God gives us are grace gifts. They are not dependent upon our behaviour, but dependent upon him who is good. So, each of us has been gifted. Paul tells us to desire the gifts in 1 Corinthians 12, 31. We should be eager to be used by God and let his anointing flow through our lives. None of us have got any excuse. Hallelujah. But then verse 11, Paul in Ephesians 4 is talking, is not talking about the list of spiritual gifts in 1 Corinthians 12. He's talking about the grace giftings of office. He's talking about the grace ministries. He himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors and teachers for the equipping of the saints, for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Apostles, evangelists, pastors and teachers. Did I mention prophets? Men and women who have been anointed for a function, a ministry within the church. A grace gifting. Nothing of themselves, not dependent on their behaviour, but the God's grace towards them. I am a pastor, not because I'm somebody special, because I've done so much study or have prayed a lot or done this, that, and the other. I am a pastor because God determined that I would be a pastor. He gave me his ministry gift by grace. You may have heard the expression fivefold ministry. These are the five ministries: apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. Some say that these functions are not for the church today, that apostles and prophets and evangelists and pastors and teachers, well, they say the apostles and prophets aren't for today, but as we shall see in a moment, the fivefold ministry, these offices, these ministries are given to the church to equip the church and build the church up. And if the church ever needs equipping and building up, it's today. Hallelujah. So I don't believe that God has walked out on the church and said, I don't need to support you anymore. You don't need to be equipped. You don't need to be spiritually built up. No, he has given these gifts of ministries to the church. The apostle, the big leader, the number one person who would have oversight over many churches. So in our context, the apostolic figure would be Chris Cartwright, who, if you don't know, is the general superintendent of Elim. He provides strategic leadership. And then there is the prophet. This is not the gift of prophecy that we see in 1 Corinthians 12. That gift of prophecy, which is the spiritual gift, is probably used more locally, more used within the church itself, within the local church for building the church up. But the office of prophet, which we're looking at now, is somebody who would speak to the nation, who would speak to the church as a whole, who would speak inspiration and motivation to the church. He would speak God's voice to motivate them and inspire them to encourage them into action, to respond in faith. And these are usually men and women who have a track record of being accurate in their perception and outcome. Now, in my research for doing this, I thought to myself, well, who are the prophets in the UK at the moment? Who are the prophets that are speaking into the nation? And maybe I could think of a few American prophets, but then I thought, well, really, we need to be relevant to the UK and see who they might be. So I just sort of put in UK prophets and came up with this website, which was let's get the title right, shall we? The British Council of Prophets. And it's a group of prophets who bounce off one another. Now, when they bounce off one another, what I mean is that these prophets really act individually. There's a grouping of prophets so that there's not one prophet who says something and it's off the wall. He'll believe that he has heard something from God. He will share it with the other prophets, and those other prophets will see before the Lord whether it resonates with them. And then after that, then that message is shared. And so this council of prophets is almost like a safeguarding group to make sure that what a prophet says isn't off the wall and not too crazy and not too wild. So there's half a dozen core leaders of this UK GB Council of Prophets and about 28 other associate members. And to be honest with you, I didn't recognise any one of the names apart from one. And part of the one man on the council is Gerard Cooper, who wrote the song King of Kings, Majesty. And then inconsequently, I did find somebody else that had spoken at Elim conference. So there was somebody else that perhaps I was familiar with. So I started listening to some of these prophets, and they all seem to be saying the same. And they all seem to be saying the same thing as the American prophets are saying. And it can be briefly summarized like this. They're saying the same thing, albeit in different ways, all with different nuances. But a very quick summary would be this. One, that there's a whole lot of shaking going on in the world. And these words were actually spoken before any of what's happened this last week. They were spoken at the beginning of January. The whole lot of shaking going on. We've seen COVID, we've seen inflation, we've seen political unrest, we've seen war. There's a whole lot of shaking going on. And Gail read this scripture earlier on from Matthew 24. And Jesus answers and said to them, "Take heed that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name, saying, 'I am the Christ,' and will deceive many. And you will hear of wars and rumors of wars. See that you are not troubled. All these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. For nation will rise against nation and kingdom against nation, and there will be famines, pestilences, and earthquakes in various places. All these things are the beginning of sorrows." You know, there's been an earthquake in Birmingham this week as well, hasn't there? Just to add to that. So the prophets are also prophesying that we're entering a time of political upheaval where even democracy as we know it is questioned as being efficient. There's a whole lot of shaking going on. But the second thing that the prophets are saying is that the church should not be troubled. Jesus himself says, "Do not see to it. See that you are not troubled." In other words, Jesus is making a point that, hey, there's a whole lot of shaking going on, but see to it that you are not troubled. Because you belong to a kingdom that cannot be shaken. Hallelujah. Here it is. "Those who trust in the Lord are like Mount Zion, which cannot be shaken, but endures forever." I think the writer to the Hebrews says this, "Let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, the kingdom of God. We stand on a solid rock, and although things around us might fall apart, we stand on the rock that can never fall apart, the name of Jesus." But then what is exciting as well is that the prophets are indicating that we are standing on the edge of a great revival, a great awakening. Amos 9:13 says this, "The days are coming, says the Lord, when grain will grow faster than it can be harvested, and grapes will grow faster than wine can be made. The mountains will drip with sweet wine, and the hills will flow with it." Hallelujah. You know, one of the things that we were saying in home groups this week is that often when somebody comes to the Lord, their journey is a long one. Their journey might take years from the time they were an atheist, then they become an agnostic, then they might become interested in some church activity, then they might come along to church, they might be witnessed to by someone else, and they might sit on the fence for a long time. And that period of time, their journey in coming to the Lord is a long one. Look at what the scripture says. The days are coming when grain will grow faster than it can be harvested. The days are coming when that long time that we usually see in people coming to the Lord is going to be very, very short. And those people that have been sitting on the fence for such a long time will no longer be sitting on the fence. There's going to be a great harvest. Some believe that it's already started. But the encouragement from the Lord, fourthly, is now is the time for the church to rise up. Now is the time for the church to proclaim the kingdom, the unshakable kingdom. You see, even in the Ukraine, we were praying earlier, weren't we, for the church who were proclaiming an unshakable message, the unshakable hope that there is in Christ Jesus. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my word will not pass away. And we have that opportunity to bring a message of security, a message of hope, a message of love, a message of forgiveness to a world that is being shaken. Now is the time for the church to rise up and proclaim the righteousness, the goodness, the faithfulness, and the graciousness of the Lord. Now is the time for the church to stand up for that which is right. 2 Timothy 4:3 says this, "For the time is coming when people will not endure sound teaching, but have itching ears. They will accumulate for themselves teachers to suit their own passions." And we'll get on to people who are tossed to and fro by doctrine next week, but just to say now that we are living in days where evil is called good and good is evil, people who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. Isaiah 5:20 says this, "You are headed for trouble. You say wrong is right, darkness is light, and bitter is sweet." Now is the time for the church to rise up and talk the truth and declare the truth. Because the enemy is taking territory, we need to take it back. We live in a world where a man is a woman and a woman is a man. We live in a world where we can't say ladies and gentlemen. We live in a world where children can't even call their mum and dad, mum and dad. School in Brighton this week who've decreed to the... Can you imagine that teachers came into a school class this last week in Brighton and said to their children, oh, by the way, boys and girls, well, they can't call them boys and girls, so I don't know what they called them. By the way, students, when mummy comes and meets you at the school gate, when daddy comes and meets you at the school gate, you're not allowed to call them mummy anymore. You're not allowed to call them daddy anymore. They're to be called grown-ups because mummy and daddy is sexist. We need, as a church, to stand up for that which is right. If we don't stand up for the truth of the gospel, then we will lose the freedom to preach it. And there's a bill before Parliament now, it's at the consultation stage, where if it follows the Australian model, it will end up illegal for the church to pray for certain people. So at the moment, if some people have their way, this would be the scenario. A man would come to me and they would say, "Pastor Ian, I have a confession that I want you to pray about because I have a problem that I want you just to pray in and I need some counselling over. I have these unwanted sexual feelings for another married woman in the congregation." And I'd say, "Come round to my house quickly, we'll pray for you." Hallelujah. And you'd expect that to be right. I'd provide counselling. I'd offer a prescription of the word, a plan of action as how we're going to overcome these sexual feelings, these unwanted sexual feelings. But if the government have the... Well, if some people have their way, if another man in the same congregation came to me and they said, "Ian, I want you to pray for me. I have a problem. I have unwanted sexual feelings towards another married man in the congregation." I'd have to say to him, "This conversation has to stop. I cannot talk to you about it. It is forbidden for me to pray for you." That's the model in Australia right now. We need to make sure it doesn't happen here. Because if the government tells us that we can't pray for people with certain needs, the next thing they'll be saying is that we can't preach to people. And boy, around the world has governments tried to crack down on the church. In some American states, I believe it was Colorado was being one of them, if not more, when we had this COVID pandemic, the churches were shut down and they said, "You cannot meet. You are not allowed to worship." But yet, The strip clubs were allowed to remain open, and the casinos were allowed to remain open. We need to stand up and make sure that we have the freedom to preach the gospel. If we don't stand up for the truth of the gospel, then we will lose the freedom to preach it. By the way, you might say, why is sexual identity that important? Why is marriage important? This is why it is important, because the husband and wife relationship is a picture of Christ's love for the church. And the enemy wants to destroy the pictures of Christ's love for you. I was listening to one of these prophets. Oh, by the way, I think as a church, we're thinking about this, that we're just going to get those people who just want to gather together and look at the stuff that the Christian Institute and other groups send through, so that we can just alert the church to action on certain issues, so that we continue to have the freedom to preach the word. We're going to get a group together so that we're not just saying these things, but actually doing something about it. So watch this space here. So anyway, I was listening to this chap called Toby Ariomi. I don't know whether I've pronounced his name right. He's a pastor of a big black church in London, and he's one of these prophets who's a member of the GB Council of Prophets. He was one of the people who actually prophesied that Boris Johnson was going to come into office. And he actually prophesied that within Boris Johnson's first few months of office, there would be a worldwide shock, a worldwide economic shock like we've never seen before. And hundreds and thousands of people, millions of people would be laid off. In hindsight, we can see that that's exactly what COVID did. So this man has a track record. And like I say, this man was somebody that was at the Elim conference. If it wasn't him, it was his brother. So very related, very closely. So anyway, I was listening to his prophetic insights for 2022. So here's the pattern. Here it is. Here's what they're all saying. There's going to be great turmoil. The world is going through a great shaking. There is fear in the world. But the church need not fear. The kingdom of God cannot be shaken. And he's following the pattern again. There's going to be a great revival. The pattern again. The church needs to rise up and be heard and take its place. And then I could have listened to one of hundreds of prophets, or no, one of loads of YouTube videos of what the prophets are saying, but I just happened to land on this fella. And I don't know whether it was godly guidance or not, but when I was listening to this fella, he went through all these four things, and then he said something that made me almost fall off my chair. Because he then said that this is going to be the year of the evangelist. The spirit of the evangelist will be seen in the church like it has never been seen before. Hallelujah. And I thought that was very relevant to what we were talking about last week. If you haven't heard last week's message, go back and listen to it again. The spirit of the evangelist. So, last week, we ended up with praying for God to raise up someone with an evangelist anointing who could lead people into the kingdom of God. That doesn't mean to say that we do nothing. We continue to do our witnessing, but that evangelist has that spirit's anointing upon his life where he pulls people across the line, over the line. Now, that's a very unbiblical and untheological way of expressing it. I'm sure that the theologians who watch might be raising their eyebrows, but it's the best way that I can describe what the evangelist does. Those people that have been sitting on the fence for so long, he talks to them and they're saved. He pulls them across the line. They've been so long on this journey, coming into faith. The evangelist turns up, and suddenly they're brought over into the kingdom, pulled across into the kingdom. And at home groups during the week, we were talking about the pull of the Holy Spirit when the evangelist talks. You have done all you have done and can with all your giftings. Now the evangelist brings them to that point of commitment, and then others with giftings encourage and support, nurture and help that person to grow in the Lord. Now, let's look at verse 12 in more detail. For the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. Let's have a look at this word equipping. Here it is in Matthew 4:21. Going on from there, he saw two other brothers, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, in the boat with Zebedee, their father, mending their nets. That word mending in the Greek language is that same word that is translated equipping. It means to prepare, to make strong. And just as the fishermen prepared their nets to catch fish, the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher prepares the church to be fishers of men. They prepare and equip them ready to be fishers of men. The pastor prepares the church for ministry. He disciples and leads them, makes them strong and ready to witness. How do they do this? Through the word of God. All scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it's profitable for doctrine, for correction, for the instruction of righteousness, that the man of God may be complete, thoroughly equipped, prepared, ready for every good work. For the equipping of the saints for the work of ministry. John Stott, the English theologian, said, one of the most crippling ideas to pervade the church over the centuries is that there is a special class of Christians called clergy who do the ministry while the rest of the church sits back and lets them do it. The pastor does it all. Pastor Stuart Briscoe told once about an incident that happened the first week that he was a pastor of Elmbrook Church. A woman came up after the service and asked if he would find the answer to a technical question that she had about a particular Bible text. Briscoe replied, "No, I will not." The woman got a shocked look on her face as if she didn't hear him correctly. "What?" she exclaimed. "No," Briscoe repeated, "I will not find the answer to your question." She looked at him as if to say, "Well, what are we paying you for?" He continued, "But here's what I will do. I'll show you how to find the answer for yourself." And he proceeded to do that for her. He equipped her, he prepared her, made her ready, equipped her for ministry. I notice that time has gone. I want to end by this. It's time for the church to arise. It's time for the church to pray. It's time for the church to start believing beyond that which we have been believing for in the past. It's time for the church to be expectant. It's time to fill this place with people who were unbelievers, who have been unbelievers for too long. Where does it all start? Well, we've already said about perhaps having a group that's going to look at social issues, where we can make a stand for the gospel. Details of that will come through. But where's the response from us? Well, I want, before we finish right now, is to think of somebody who we are believing will come into the kingdom. Now, bear in mind what I've been saying is that so often we say, well, it's going to take a long time. Well, the time is coming now when that time that was long is going to be short. Think of those people that you know who have been sitting on the fence for far too long. Think of those people that are far away from God and you think will never come to that point of it's going to be a long time before they make a decision. Well, I want to encourage you to be expectant that even though they might be far off, they could be making a commitment very shortly. Because now is the time of harvest. Now is the time when God is stirring by his Spirit in the world. And there's going to be a great awakening. So who are you thinking of right now? Think of somebody. Think of somebody, because we're going to pray for them. Too impossible. Oh no, that would never happen. I want you to think again. Remember what we were talking about a few weeks ago, about how God can superabundantly do beyond that which we ask or imagine. So don't limit God. In fact, the more impossible, the better. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. You do this at home as well. You'll be thinking of somebody that you are believing, that you are going to be expecting to give their life to the Lord very, very shortly, to get off the fence. And as things will do stuff as a church that will equip you to help them over the line, as well as praying for the evangelist that will come and equip us. Hallelujah. Who are you thinking of? As I was praying, preparing for this, this is just whether this is from the Lord or not. I don't know. I'm not going to proclaim any great thing, but I'll share it nevertheless because it might be an encouragement to somebody. It might be an encouragement to somebody here. It might be an encouragement to somebody at home. But when I ask you to think of a name, the Lord would encourage whoever thought of somebody by the name of Anthony that God is going to move in their life. All right. Now, here's a bit more detail, because it could well be that there are plenty of Antonys around this place, you know, and you think to yourself, well, is it me or is it isn't? Let's narrow it down, because this Anthony is, people want to call him Tony, but he says, no, my name is Anthony. Or it's something like his parents called him Anthony, and it's something right around that name Tony, but there is a determination by somebody in the family that wants to call him Anthony. It may be himself or it may be his parents. If that were you, be encouraged. If that were you at home, be encouraged. God is going to do something special in that person's life. Father, thank you that you're going to do something special in the lives of every name that we've been thinking of. Thank you, Lord, that the time is coming, if it's not already arrived, when seed will be sown and it will be harvested more or less immediately. We'll find it difficult to keep up. Thank you, Jesus. And so we're believing and we're expecting. We're expectant for these people. Thank you, Jesus. Help us to do our part in witnessing. And Lord, thank you, Lord, that their place is reserved in heaven. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. It would be interesting to know if anybody identifies with this Tony or Anthony, to let me know, just to hear, so if I know that I'm off the wall, or whether I actually did hear from God on that. So if that were you, let me know by email at info@hvelim.org.uk. Amen. Time has gone. Joshua, let's sing the last song. Don't forget that we love you and that God loves you. God's on your side, that you're blessed by the best. If you want to call us, 01484323978 is our telephone number. 07472773243 is my mobile for texts. info@hvelim.org.uk. That's it for the email. Bless you. God loves you. See you next week. Amen.